So to not all imaging studies are created equal. And I think that is a really important point that hopefully over the next 28 questions we'll get down to, is that a CT doesn't equal an MR, doesn't equal a DOTATATE PET. And one isn't always better than the other in all circumstances, okay? So the best imaging modality to detect small disease is a DOTATATE PET. Okay. Now, if you have a DOTATATE PET, you might see focal uptake in the terminal ileum, which can show you a neuroendocrine tumor in the small bowel. The best way to see the anatomic correlate in the small bowel to a focal uptake on DOTATATE PET is going to be a CT scan. Now, there are different types of CT scans, just to make it more complicated, right? We have different timing of the contrast, so a multiphasic CT, and then we also have CT enterography, where we give fluids to the patient to drink, and that distends the bowel, and that allows us to see these small tumors in the bowel wall better. So you can also use that technique. The CT enterography also helps us look at potential obstruction and sees if there's transition points where there's an obstruction. So all of these different things would help us see where the tumor is in the small bowel. In general, and this is not always true, but in general, MR is not as good at looking for small bowel tumors, but there is a technique called an MR enterography where you can also try to look for small bowel tumors. And remember, this is only really useful at the initial staging setting. So you shouldn't be following over time with CT enterographies. At most, you'll get this one time, and then you'll follow with other imaging modalities after that. On a CT scan, huh? So that really depends. First of all, I'm sort of hesitant to even give a number because I don't want someone to worry about a number. It depends on where your disease is. And one of the things about a CT scan that's different than a DOTATATE PET is you don't know if something's tumor. So you can see lymph nodes that are really small, but I don't know if that really small lymph node's tumor or not. And so that's why I think it's really helpful to get a DOTATATE PET. It tells you where the tumor is, and then I know that tumor is cancer, or that lymph node is cancer, and then I repeat a CT and I can watch this little thing grow, right? And so I know which nodes are actually tumor when I'm following up with the CT. So for lymph nodes, you can see it's pretty much as small as you want, but you just don't know what's tumor or not. In the liver, liver metastases are common. About 50% of patients at diagnosis have liver metastases and patients who have small bowel and neuroendocrine tumor. And so in that setting, with a CT, you can see, depending on the type of CT done and also the tumor itself, something around a centimeter or something like that. But I wouldn't, as a patient, get too focused on the sizes. You know, you're worrying about probably the wrong thing if you're worried about sizes that small. Okay, so uptake here is probably the word's a little confusing. So when you give a radioligand, like gallium 68 dotatate or gallium 68 dotatate, it binds to the tumor and goes in the tumor, and then we image it with a PET scan, and we call that uptake. We use a term called SUV, a standardized uptake value, which we can measure how much of the radioligand went there. So when I use the term uptake, I'm referring to a PET study, a radioactive imaging study, and I'm referring to how much uptake, how much of this radioligand went to the tumor. So that's when I use uptake, that's what I'm referring to. When you get a CT scan, you inject contrast. It usually is an iodinated contrast, so it contains a lot of iodine. It's about 100, it's about a Coke can worth of volume that we inject into the patient. And what that is it's just dense material. And a CT scan measures density, and so in essence, what I can see is where that dense material goes in a patient's body. Now, the thing that's sort of cool is as we inject this dense material, it goes into your veins and your arms. It'll then go to your heart, and then your heart will pump it to the rest of your body. Okay, so I can watch it if I wanted to. I can watch the density go into your heart and then to the rest of the body. As it goes to the rest of your body, then that density will go into your tumor. It goes into the tumor dynamically, right? So the arteries get fed first. So if there's arterial enhancement, that means your tumor and your liver is primarily fed by arteries. If it's venous, then it's primarily fed by vein. So I can look at the characteristics of enhancement, which is just really how this iodine or the dense material flows through your tumor. So with a CT scan, I'm not measuring uptake because the iodine doesn't stay or go into the tumor at all. It's just passing through the tumor. It's just how it's fed by blood vessels. And the way it's fed by blood vessels can help us characterize and find disease. So it's really sort of detectability. The contrast helps us see these tumors better, but it's not uptake in the same sense as the uptake on a DOTATATE PET, where you're actually having the radioactivity go into the tumor and collect in the tumor. Okay, so with lung neuroendocrine tumors, one thing that's very helpful is actually you don't need contrast to visualize the lungs. The lungs themselves provide contrast. The lungs look like air to a CT, and a tumor grows in there, and you can see small little nodules very well, even like 2 to 3 millimeter nodules in the lung we see very easily. So if you're looking for recurrence in the lungs itself, CT is the best way to do it, and you don't need contrast for that. Separate from that, you will still want to know whether or not your disease is somatostatin receptor avid. And bronchial carcinoids are a little complicated. You have these typical, atypical, and then more poorly differentiated subtypes. And if you're a typical bronchial carcinoid, you're likely to be somatostatin receptor avid across all of your disease. So in that setting, a DOTATATE or DOTATATE PET is helpful. If you're more poorly differentiated, you want an image using a FDG-PET, a sugar PET, rather than a somatostatin receptor PET. Now, you can also get MR with contrast to look for disease in the abdomen and the pelvis. So a liver MR is very helpful for evaluating for liver metastases, which are actually surprisingly common in bronchial carcinoids. The one thing we would have a hard time seeing anatomically are mediastinal lymph nodes, so lymph nodes in the chest, without CT with contrast can be very hard to see. So that's the one area without giving contrast we would struggle with in the patient with bronchial carcinoid. Fibrosis. Trying to think of the motive to ask that question. Yeah. So in general, we don't image fibrosis. And what I mean by that is we don't have a molecule that goes to fibrosis. There are this in the research realm. So for example, in lung fibrosis, there's MR imaging agents and also radionuclides that will go to fibrosis, but we don't do that in a neuroendocrine tumor. I think the question's getting at if you have a carcinoid, a small bowel carcinoid, carcinoids secrete serotonin. Serotonin causes desmoplasia or fibrosis, and the fibrosis typically causes small bowel obstruction, or it can narrow the blood vessels that feed the liver from the small bowel, which can cause mesenteric ischemia and small bowel obstruction. So I think the question is, can you image that fibrosis that's usually in the root of the mesentery or around the primary tumor? And the best way to try to get an idea of that is through CT. So you can anatomically see sort of this, it looks like fingers coming out from your tumor, and those fingers sort of grab on to adjacent bowel and cause obstruction or narrowings, and that's what we would be looking for. But to actually image directly, and I'm probably making this more complicated because I've actually spent time in my life trying to image fibrosis. but no, we don't directly image fibrosis, but we can image the anatomic appearance, that sort of we use the term desmoplasia, sort of this band-like stretching out of fibrous tissue out from the tumor that causes these complications in patients with carcinoid. So an MIBG scan is another nuclear medicine study imaged using SPECT CT and not PET, so a little bit lower resolution. MIBG is in essence, an analog of a neurotransmitter. So remember, DOTATATE is an analog of somatostatin. So DOTATATE binds to the somatostatin hormone and then goes into the tumor cells and in essence functions as a hormone. MIBG, in essence, sort of looks to your body like norepinephrine. And so it gets taken up into tumors that have norepinephrine reuptake protein. So if you think about at nerve terminus, the norepinephrine gets secreted and it gets taken back up into the nerve ending. There are certain types of tumors that have a lot of these types of proteins on the cell surface. So MIBG, just like DOTATATE, can collect inside the tumor. There are certain specific subtypes of neuroendocrine tumors that happen to have expression of this type of protein, and that would be paraganglioma and pheochromocytomas. In that type of patient, a paraganglioma and pheochromocytoma, MIBG has a role. Outside of that, for example, for a small bowel or pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, there's very little role to doing MIBG imaging.